Have you heard of the trolley problem? In 1967, philosopher Philip of Foote developed the thought exercise. Imagine you are standing by a railway and you notice in the distance there is a trolley or part of a locomotive that is hurtling down the tracks. Its brakes have failed and there is danger. You see that the trolley is on a collision course with five workers. Next to you, you notice a large lever. If you pull this lever, you can shift the track the trolley is on, but this leads to a collision with another worker. The lives of the five original workers are saved. Another worker reaches their demise. What would you do? How would being in such a situation impact your life? There is an early variant of the trolley problem known as the bridge variant. Now imagine you are atop of a bridge, the railway is below you, and instead to stop the trolley, you must push a large man over the edge to crash down on the railway, to derail the trolley, save the five workers, but leading to his demise. Are these two versions of the trolley car problem actually different? What would you do in such a situation? And indeed, there is a large body of literature associated with this thought exercise, from changing the number of people to having backstories on the individuals, from age to profession. And perhaps best encapsulated is in 1982, screenwriter Jack Sowards brought to the silver screen a concept for a computer simulation known as the Kobayashi Maru. In this simulation, taking place in the future, in the 23rd century, cadets who would one day make life or death decisions on fantastic starships would be obliged to select between two no-win options. Regardless of what the cadet did in the situation, in the simulation, the end result would be two bad options. I was first interested in the trolley car problem during my research and training across Columbia, Cornell, and Princeton universities. In 2004, something remarkable happened, the DARPA Autonomous Vehicle Challenge. It was mayhem. You had vehicles crashing into barriers, despite having quite interesting backgrounds, such as dune buggy, sandstorm. There was even in the early challenges an autonomous motorcycle. What was rather striking in 2005, just 1 year, all but one of the competitors exceeded what was done the year before. This is reminiscent of the rapid transition in my hometown of New York from horse and buggy to automobile, whereby the horses were prevalent to that of it's hard to find a horse. And in hindsight, it makes sense that the horses were overtaken by cars. Cars don't eat per se. They take up less space in aggregate, and they can go faster and further. What's striking here with autonomous vehicles, though, and what I want to shed a light on, is that it is the driver's livelihood that is primarily at risk. And so often the dichotomy is presented as human or machine. And with autonomous vehicles, it is indeed competing with things such as distracted driving or sleepy driving. The question is, how do we adapt the jobs of the future to make use of the strengths of machines and humans? Previously, as the chief science officer for a 100,000-person organization, as well as an innovation investor, I have seen firsthand how discoveries in the laboratories can lead to shifts of entire industries. What we are considering now is how to increase your intuition, and also I want to convey specific steps and strategies you can take to preserve your livelihood as well as for your family. Let's take a basic example to start. Every day, we look at our inbox for email, and you may realize in the last few years, you're using effectively a priority inbox. There is natural language processing associated with looking at the emails. Then there is a layer of machine learning on top of that, and then an AI-based system on top of that in terms of making decisions of what to look at. So what's going on here, in the same way computer vision supports machine learning to support an AI-based systems to make decisions, we have similarly with your email a way for reading or in different contexts listening, computer audition for example, having a very similar chain. If we extend this further, for example, in your pocket right now, you may have an application known as Shazam, widely used, and in a way, it's an AI-based assistant to help you find music you are looking for. This would suggest that it's possible then to build Nazam, where the human sense of smell is put into the machine, perhaps for personalized perfume or industrial security to increase safety for workers. Indeed, in the old coal mines, there were not horses, but canaries that were used as a type of early warning system. What I want to show here is that our senses, whether it's our sense of sight, light impinging on our retina and being processed by our visual cortex, or sound waves impinging on our eardrum being processed by our auditory cortex. Similarly, our olfactory bulb working on as per our sense of smell, we now have the ability to work with AI-based systems that extend our own sensory capability. And so in the same way computer literacy was critical a generation ago, permeating only a few jobs, then almost all jobs, we are at a point in time where the same is happening for AI literacy. To engage in AI literacy, we need an interface. So with computers, we are pointing and clicking. For AI literacy, that interface can hold as well. Researcher Vartuhi Razarian specifically is working on, has made scholarly contributions in this area, extending her work at Oxford University to the American University on how a computer, an AI-based system, can take a guess at an image task and then provide a way for the human to also guess. This in turn leads into not a removal of human labor, but a force multiplication. And so, how are you in earnest able to engage? What if you realize that you are the large man on the bridge, and someone is considering pushing your job or your entire profession off of it? So there's three strategies I'd like to underscore. With the rise of machines, it becomes absolutely critical to be able to communicate with humans. You can pick, for example, languages to learn that are spoken by many people. English, Arabic, Chinese, Russian, Ukrainian, Swedish, Spanish, French, and of course, Armenian. And beyond language, it's vital to understand aspects of culture. And this includes norms for communicating, as well as a person's priorities. Secondly, it's important to be able to communicate with machines. Machines have an aspect of culture and norms for communicating as per conveying confidence on a recommendation, adapting to your language, adapting to your preferences. Developing intuition here is very important, in the same way all of us have developed intuition about how to troubleshoot our computer. In particular, a small child can learn the basics of computer programming, understanding control structures such as if-else statements, as well as for loops. Moreover, it's possible to learn about data structures, arrays, matrices, and there is absolutely no reason why today you can't spend 4 hours with an interactive web tutorial to learn the absolute basics. This type of intuition and ability to do a base amount of programming can be quite impactful as you think about designing processes outside of being in front of one single screen, which might encapsulate your current role. The point is that not everyone becomes a computer programmer, but in the same way we all have to be comfortable using computers, we will likely have to be increasingly comfortable in our roles to use AI-based systems. Third, think positive sum as opposed to zero sum. The thinking that for someone to win, someone must lose is particularly dangerous with AI-based systems. Because if you are head-to-head with an AI system, the amount of throughput you could do versus that system can do is on an order of magnitude difference at the very least. However, if you view such a system as more of a sparring partner, as opposed to someone trying to knock you out, it's possible to increase performance, whether that's a team working in drug safety, analyzing a large stack of documents similar to our email but distributed, or in financial analysis, or in content marketing. So with this frame of reference, a machine plus a team of humans can outperform a human or a machine. To close, I would like to share a unifying perspective. I was fortunate to complete a trip around the world, from Manila to Abu Dhabi to Dubai, to Austin, to Houston, to Los Angeles, New York, and here to Yerevan. It is clear that the world is grappling with challenges that have data at their core, from food security in the desert to that of engaging entire populations for economic prosperity. I remain optimistic that AI can help us solve some of the grand challenges of our time. Indeed, the Kobayashi Maru was beaten once. It took some clever programming, a lot of teamwork, and a belief that no-win situations, such as the trolley car problem, are just thought exercises. Thank you.